Hi there, I'm Miranda Luna, and I'm a product manager on the Windows Azure mobile team. I'm here today with my good buddy, Kirill.
Hi, and I'm Kirill Gavriluk. I'm lead program manager on Windows Azure mobile team, responsible for mobile services and notification hubs.
And today, you know, you might have joined us earlier in the day. We covered notification hubs, which was great, and then moved on to consumer-facing applications, primarily using mobile services and notification hubs. So in this module, what we're going to really focus on is how do you build secure mobile applications in the enterprise, and what services in Azure do we provide that kind of give you the tool set you need in order to accomplish that. So to give you an idea of where we're headed today, we're going to do a quick overview. We're going to talk about data with a particular eye towards, you know, how you would connect to an on-premises database if you needed to. We're going to cover what business logic looks like in mobile services because, you know, we've obviously gotten a lot of customer feedback that a pretty popular scenario is adding a mobility layer on top of an existing application. Then we're going to move on to authentication and do a great demo on Azure Active Directory and mobile services. Azure Active Directory, of course, giving you a tunnel back into your on-prem AD if you'd want to make sure that you can extend your corporate credentials to mobile devices. And then we'll close by taking a look at push notifications, which will be a recap for those of you who have been here with us the whole day. Then we'll move on to best practices and point you towards some resources and have a small lunch break. So if you're ready, we'll get going. Again, the target audience here is going to be developers building mobile applications, regardless of platform, iOS, Android, or Windows, but with a special eye towards employee-facing applications and what you need to do in the enterprise when you're thinking about security in addition to scalability and enabling a workforce that, you know, has credentials already in Active Directory and that or adding mobility layer on top of your existing on-prem data and systems. If you're downloading the deck, there are some helpful links there. If you go to channel 9, you can find the mobile services channel. And if you go to aka.ms/commonwams, you'll find a long list of helpful resources on Chris Reisner's website. Chris is an evangelist on the mobile team, and he maintains a great list of resources that are available not just in the Windows Azure Developer Center or MSDN, but also that the community's created and samples that he's produced. So it's a great resource. One quick reminder to join the MVA community. You know, over 1 million members of this community, people facing similar challenges to what you are. Great opportunity to learn not just from content and, you know, watching sessions like this today, but from each other. So highly encourage you to get started and definitely use that voucher if you want to kind of get going with Windows Azure and earn some points. So to get started with an overview, again, apologies to our friends who have been with us for a couple episodes. This is going to be a quick recap for anybody who's new. In Windows Azure, there are four compute models in which you could host a mobile app backend. You know, what you're going to be doing is trading off, as you can see on these axes. You're going to be trading off between degree of customizability all the way to speed of development and ease of maintenance. If we start on the right and think about mobile services, which we're going to focus on today, we've really made a lot of investments in kind of enabling and making those common mobile application development tasks like user authentication, push notifications, storing data a lot easier. And we also give you a scripting environment. We've really focused on that vertical. If you go kind of more towards the left, you'll see that you kind of gain customizability. You know, in websites, you could pick you could choose whatever language you want on the back end. You know, currently in mobile services, we offer JavaScript for scripting on the server side. We're going to support C# as well, but that's coming. And then you could go all the way up to virtual machines where you're controlling everything, like exactly when and if you want to patch the OS. Customers are definitely building mobile applications using all of these compute models today, some of which might tell you they wish mobile services was available when they built that application. But, you know, definitely we have the service to fit the need of the application. Today we are going to focus on mobile services because we really think that value brought to you by speed of development and the ongoing ease of maintenance is something you can really benefit from when you're thinking about mobile applications in the enterprise, where, you know, you don't want to have a fire drill at the last second because you know, some protocol or connection string change that you can't control. You know, you can really rest a lot easier knowing that we're going to update everything. We're going to deploy those patches for you. A quick flag for notification hubs, which we'll talk about later. Notification hubs is not a compute model. It's not an environment in which you can build logic. It's simply a very powerful push notification service that you can use with any application backend, whether that's on-premises or in the cloud, highly encourage you to look at the presentation Elio and I did earlier this morning. It covers everything that you need to know about notification hubs. Just want to flag, you know, what a customer has done today. We talked about that scenario where you're adding a mobility layer on top of existing functionality, systems and data you might have on premises. You know, TalkTalk Business is a major telco in the UK, and what they wanted to do is to give their users a better way to access their account information from their mobile devices. You know, to get alerts when a new build available, or to get an alert when there's going to be a service interruption, and to kind of track the progress of that. You'll see here that, you know, we have a Windows Store and Windows Phone app displayed, but they also have apps available on Android and iOS, and they were really looking for a way to efficiently reach all those platforms so that, you know, the systems they have on premises, where, you know, they have all that sensitive customer data, you know, that data is available on mobile devices, but it's not stored in the cloud, and it's still reaching devices on so many different platforms. So they turned to mobile services and Service Bus Relay to enable that functionality. And we'll talk through a little bit more about how you could accomplish the same thing. But it's just really important to note that it can be done in production today. And it's a little cut off there on the left, but if you go to aka.ms/ttb, you'll be able to see a video case study where they talk through some of the challenges they were facing and how mobile services helped. We're going to take a minute to dive into each of these areas today with special focus on the more enterprise features and kind of what should be top of mind as you build employee-facing applications. But just to flag, you know, mobile services and every Azure compute model supports development for any mobile application platform. So in mobile services, we have SDKs for building native Android, iOS, Windows Phone, Windows Store apps. We also partner with Xamarin so that if you wanted to build an iOS or Android app in C Sharp and share a lot of that code in between platforms, you can absolutely do that. In terms of storing data in the cloud, you know, not only are we going to give you a SQL database out of the box, but we understand that you probably have a SQL Server running on-prem or SQL Server in a VM or maybe even Oracle that you want to connect to. And we're going to talk through how you might be able to accomplish that. In terms of user authentication, you know, definitely known that mobile services supports, you know, Facebook, Twitter type auth, as well as custom identity. If you wanted somebody to create an identity just within your application using email and password. We also have Azure Active Directory authentication as an option, and we're going to demo that today so that you can see how you can use your existing employees' credentials to authenticate them in a mobile application, available on whichever platform. And then for push notifications, you know, mobile services does support push notifications for iOS, Android, or Windows, but it's important to note that we really recommend using notification hubs, and we'll flag kind of why that is. For all your push needs, just because, you know, you might be thinking, why do I need notification hubs? They talk about scale. I watched the consumer episode, and they were talking about, well, hey, if you go from 10,000 to 10 million users, notification hub scales without you even noticing. But it has some really good security features for the enterprise, as well as, you know, working with Signalar and other areas of Service Bus so that you can get, you know, delivery confirmation, end-to-end encryption, things like that. We'll talk a little bit about it. In scripting, that's going to be where you build all your business logic. You know, not only the ability to add some custom logic on CRUD operations on a SQL database table, but also to run scripts on a schedule. And obviously, custom API, you can npm install any node module you'd like and share any code you'd like between scripts. Source control, again, enabling that team development environment that is obviously going to be table stakes in the enterprise. Without that, it's going to be pretty difficult for a distributed team to work on an application together. So that's going to hopefully, we'll give you a little bit demo of that and give you an idea of how you can get up and running with your team to build an employee-facing application. Before we run forward, I just wanted to flag again the supported platforms. And, you know, you'll see a variety of apps. You know, the great thing about mobile services is that it supports enterprise and consumer scenarios. You know, everything from TalkTalk, like we mentioned, where they really need to pull on-prem data and expose that in new ways, all the way to consumer-facing applications like Oz Postcards, which gives people a way to make a postcard out of any picture they take on their phone. So, Kirill, do you want to talk a little bit about the differentiating characteristics of mobile applications in the enterprise?
Definitely. The first that you obviously will face is that if you're building a business-to-employee application, you want to authenticate using the corporate user credentials that you have. Most likely, you have some directory. And Windows Azure Active Directory is a great way for you to sync your local directory with Windows Azure Active Directory and enable your cloud backends to authenticate your users with the corporate credentials. In mobile services, we recently announced that we support Windows Azure Active Directory integration. And now you can easily extend the power of mobile services and the ease of use and ease of maintainability of mobile services to your line of business apps. Second thing you notice is that most of the time with line of business applications, data lives on-prem. Your application works with some data that is securely guarded as per within the network of your corporation. Mobile services allow you to access data on-premise. We have today a service bus relay functionality in Windows Azure that allows you to establish a relay connection between your a cloud backend like a mobile service and your on-premise system. Typically what you do is you would wrap your data on-premise in a API. It could be a REST API, it could be a WebCF service, doesn't really matter. Once you wrap it in a REST API, you can configure it to relay connectivity from the outside of the world into that API. And then you can use that relayed connection from your mobile services scripts. Third observation that you'll obviously make is that when it comes to line of business applications, data tends to be more complex than just to-do items that we love so much to present to demo to you every time. While mobile services give you an impression that the only thing it supports is just simple tables with few columns, you can actually work with data of any complexity. In the end, you have scripting environment in mobile services, and we'll show you in the demo. You have a scripting environment in mobile services. Currently, we support JavaScript. And in JavaScript, you can work with arbitrary hierarchy of objects. You can use full power of T-SQL right from your mobile services JavaScript. And you can work with complex data. You can also project not only, by default, we create SQL tables for you whenever you create a table API in mobile services. You can easily project your views, any updatable views or read-only views from your SQL database to a mobile service table API. Miranda mentioned a really great example of TokTok Business that needed a way to expose an existing system to a mobile application. And that's a very popular scenario in the enterprise. And it's even more popular, it's actually the scenario for line of business apps. Mobile service is a great way to add a mobility layer to your existing system. If you have a website or if you have some business logic layer living as a service, a bunch of services, you can easily extend them to your mobile applications and add things like push notifications or authenticating with mobile specific identity or doing any additional kind of working with mobile protocols that are more acceptable on mobile devices. While your system may be returning SOAP, you can translate it to JSON and consume it easier from your mobile devices. For all of those needs, mobile services is a great way to add a mobility layer to your existing system. Finally, push notifications is an essential aspect of your mobile application. Whether it's a consumer app where push gives you the dominant way and the most effective way of reaching out to your audience and engaging with your audience and making the app more dynamic. And in line of business, push notifications gives you a way to make your employee more effective. Push notifications is the way how multitasking works on a mobile device. You can only see one screen at a time. Push notifications allow you to flip between. An app cannot live on your mobile device for longer than 10 seconds unless you're actually using it. Push notifications allow you to wake up the app and allows you to get the alerts even if the app is not running. Push notifications are important for line of business apps and mobile services. If you need to build a new backend or if you need to add a mobility layer to your existing backends, you choose mobile services. And then you can use notification hubs to from your mobile services off your from your other backend to send push notifications to your app.
So that was a great overview. Moving on to kind of deep dive into data, now that we kind of level set with those scenarios, you know, we obviously get, you talked a lot about how we support Azure SQL Database out of the box. That's provisioned immediately when you create a mobile service, or you can connect to an existing one. We showed that demo in the consumer facing. But do you want to talk through some of the challenges that maybe people are going to run into if they want to connect to an on-prem system, whether that's, you know, maybe they want to pull data out of a SQL database or SQL server running on-prem, or maybe Oracle, or what if they have, you know, even Salesforce CRM that they want to be able to push a notification to that mobility layer if there's a new lead added or something like that?
Well, definitely. Almost always, every time, when you have an existing system and you want to extend it to a mobile app, you always want to add some mobility layer. Whether it adds push notifications to it or whether it just massages the data that you want to return to your mobile app, the layer is there. If your data lives on-premise, which is most likely if you're building a line of business app, it's best to wrap it in a RESTful layer. You can connect and host some service layer on-prem. Then you can connect it via service bus relay to a cloud backend like mobile service. Typically, you would work from the mobile service when it comes to on-premise data, you would work with APIs that you exposed rather than with the SQL directly. And you would, from there on, the rest of the typically the resources that you expose on-prem is CRUD resources, and they map very easily to the concept of tables in mobile services. So you can use mobile services tables and project your on-prem data resource this way. You can also wrap it in a custom API that mobile services have and add even more logic and more transformation and more interesting ways of how to work with on-prem data. You're not limited to just using SQL Server. You can use anything you like with mobile services. We run your scripting environment in Node.js. You can use any module you like and work with any data source of your choice.
And, you know, we did want to flash these up on the screen in terms of some helpful enterprise integration scenarios. These are coming out of Paolo from the CAT team. His last name stumps me a couple times. But basically, those scenarios Kirill just mentioned in terms of using service bus relay with SOAP or with REST, Paolo has some great samples. And if you go to aka.ms/commonwams, you're going to be able to quickly find those exact samples, and they'll lead you right there. Again, a flag for BizTalk services, which is definitely something that, you know, is a concern in the enterprise. You know, how I have these all these disparate applications. How do I do some of that integration I need to? Paolo showed you, you know, how you can get up and running in that environment if you'd like. And they're pretty detailed, so you're gonna definitely find all your questions answered there. So again, if you go to aka.ms/commonwams, you're gonna find those links to these four samples. They're also available in the deck. So moving on to that business logic layer, which we talked about is really kind of adding a value when you think about adding mobility layer on top of existing on-prem systems or business logic that you have. You know, we have three different scripting environments, and currently JavaScript, but C# coming soon.
Absolutely. Yes. In fact, it's with C#, we're making our business logic even better for line of business applications by making it a lot more more flexibility. We are going to embrace web API. A lot of great things coming with the .NET support on mobile services. So keep looking for it.
Yeah, definitely. Let's jump into just a quick cover of what source control and NPM enable. We've talked about the extensibility in terms of extending your on-prem systems, but if you think about the scripting environment we provide, it's a way of extending what we give you out of the box. You know, we're really here to get you started and to make sure that the maintenance is very easy going forward, but we know that we're not going to be able to cover every scenario that comes up. You know, you're going to want to use other Windows Azure services. Great. The Azure module for Node.js. You know, you're going to want to use other third-party services. Fantastic. We're working really hard to put as many partner services that we hear customers need into the store. And if you go to feedback.windowsazure.com, there's a user voice account where you can tell us exactly what you want to see next. We definitely take that in customer feedback into planning. And then again, you know, that same scripting layer and source control lets you NPM install any node module you'd like and get off and running. You can share methods between scripts and have that. And that's what we're going to show you now.
Awesome. All right, let's take a look at it. If you've been with us in the previous episode, where we talked about the consumer apps and how to scale them, you may be familiar with our service Great Friday. That does very important work about tracking my to-do items, which Miranda can attest I always forget. So if you look at the at our service, Miranda mentioned all the different ways how you can add business logic and extend your mobile service with custom logic running in the cloud. In some sense, you can think of mobile service as an API builder and a great way place to host your API, because as opposed to the kind of traditional hosting environments, we take care of and we manage this mobile service. You only need to worry about the logic that you added and extended your mobile service with. And we'll tell you and we'll ping you if there's anything wrong going on with it. So mobile services save a lot from the operational cost that you typically incur running a service. So if you look at the our items table, you can extend CRUD operations against the table API with the script tab, and adding here the additional scripts to override the insert, update, delete, and read operations. You can also look at the API tab, and you can add arbitrary custom APIs that are not restricted by the CRUD shape and can do anything you like that you can do in Node.js. We also have a scheduler tab that allows you to create a scheduled job. And this would be creating a job. Once you create it, you can add a script that will be running on a precise schedule by us. And this is great if you want to do some cleaning background job, or if you want to do background processing, et cetera, as part of your application. So all these ways where you can extend your mobile service with your custom logic, not to mention that you can add, if you want to, you can add a worker role and integrate it with your mobile service. You're not boxed in what mobile service provides out of the box. You can get out of the box, and you can go and add a worker role to your mobile service. You can add a web role, anything you like. So obviously, you may ask yourself, do I really want to edit my scripts in the browser? We certainly agree that you shouldn't. So you can enable a source control, and this mobile service already has source control enabled, but you would typically have enable source control link. And once you enable source control, you can work with and edit your scripts on the client. So if I go and add Friday, and I'm gonna go to my mobile service, and I'm gonna get the Git URL from my mobile service configure page.
Yeah.
Right here. I'm gonna copy it, and now I can clone my Git repository. Effectively, mobile service, there is a Git repository associated with it. And you can connect it to either your local Git repository, or you can connect it with GitHub and enable continuous integration from the GitHub hosted repository, or you can connect it with TFS and enable TFS push into your mobile service, changes to your sources. So here I'm going to just integrate it with local Git. So I'm going to clone my Git repository. I'm going to provide my credentials. Excellent. And
right password.
Yes. Now we have our Great Friday, and we have service folder in it. And once I look at it, I see all my APIs, tables, and scheduler scripts right here in the respective folders. So if I'm going to go into the table, I see this items.insert script which is exactly the script that I showed you previously in the portal. I can edit it in the IDE of my choice. And I can add some very important validation logic here, like or some augmentation of the data, or I can access the on-premise data from the script, anything I like. So in this case, I'm just going to add some silly data augmentation, and I'm going to save it. I'm going to git commit. All right,
So there you were able to edit the scripts locally, and then you're just going to push it back up.
Exactly.
With git commit. Great.
Yes.
And if their favorite IDE isn't Notepad, they'll still find that supported, of course, right? If they want to edit those in Visual Studio, they can absolutely do that. You know, you saw the integration with Visual Studio earlier, both with notification hubs and mobile services. So definitely something there that'll make it easier.
All right. All right. I think I'm... Anyway, So now you can keep pushing it your changes to the scripts, and you will see them in your mobile service. You can do similar thing using continuous integration from GitHub or from TFS, and achieve your goals this way. And that allows you many different things. Working with scripts now, you can add your work with the on-prem SQL data, you can add push notifications to your scripts, and many other actions that you like your application to do on the back end.
Oh, fantastic. So moving on to authentication, which obviously important. We talked a lot about Active Directory earlier and how Azure Active Directory provides that gateway to your on-prem corporate credential system. So, you know, we really wanted to flag that, you know, we gave a turnkey experience to Active Directory, even though, you know, you could have used it with mobile services from the get-go through that Azure module for Node.js. We wanted to make that very turnkey because we know in the enterprise, you know, maintaining your Active Directory, all those corporate credentials has enough hoops to jump through, and you have, you know, their Active Directory teams constantly pushing updates to make it easier. But that should really be the focus, is making sure that you have an up-to-date list of employees and that they're happy with their access to different systems and applications, not configuring it to work with mobile services. So we definitely invested in making that a turnkey experience, and we're going to show you how that works today.
Excellent. So getting back to our service, you can see that on Identity tab, we have a setting for Windows Azure Active Directory. You can get it by enlisting into a preview of Windows Azure Active Directory, and we'll show you how to do that. Right. Once you enlist it, you want to copy this URL that we pre-generate for you. This URL identifies your app. You need to go to Active Directory. In the management portal, and you go to the Active Directory and you add an application. And when you add an application, it's going to walk you through steps of the wizard, which we're not going to skip for brevity. But you're going to paste the URL in this wizard to identify your application, and you're going to get back a client ID that allows your application to authenticate that the user has the rights to talk to your app. We're going to go back to mobile service, and we're going to paste your client ID here. It's very easy for you on the client to make authenticating calls using Windows Azure Active Directory. Right here we have mobile services has a very simple login methods that you can use. And and you can choose, oh, I have an outdated SDK. You can choose one of the options here would be Windows Azure Active Directory. And from there on, you can it will bring up the right, just by adding one line of code, it will bring up the right dialog. It will authenticate your app using Windows Azure Active Directory. And then your service will let the request through.
And since it's still in preview today, you would need to add that extra package. You can gain access to the preview by emailing the team at mobileservices@microsoft.com. And once you do that and go through the kind of getting started steps, you'll see Active Directory as an option right where you saw Facebook, Twitter, and other providers.
Yes.
So just we're going to leave that slide on the screen so that you guys know what to email if you'd like to get access to the preview. But do we want to talk a little bit about kind of how you would tackle roles, role-based access control now that you have Active Directory set up?
Yeah, definitely. Addition of Active Directory to mobile services was very logical. One of the things that you... Mobile services gives you two value adds, right? It's ease of development and it reduces the cost of the operational costs, which is very important for your line of business apps because typically you have lots of line of business apps and you don't want to spend a lot of time maintaining the backend for them. With mobile services, it's very easy to achieve. Once we added Active Directory support, we get the token from Active Directory. Now you can assert the claims that the token contains. And so now you have ability within your mobile services scripts to validate where does this user belongs to, and in the future we're gonna add role based access control in a more declarative way to the mobile service, so you can actually enforce the claims declaratively as opposed to write code. But even now you can easily add in JavaScript, you can easily add statements that allows you to assert claims that particular user have against particular table operations or against particular APIs.
And is there anything you'd recommend if somebody, like for example, was building a conference application? They want all the users who are authenticated via Active Directory to have access to a superset of information, but then maybe attendees who aren't part of the same company who authenticate with a custom ID or with Facebook or Twitter to get a subset of that, maybe just the sessions that they can attend. How should somebody think about starting to tackle a problem like that?
Well, you can do it in two ways. A direct way would be to check which token. Once the app authenticates with a mobile service, on every request that's coming from that user, you have a token attached that tells the mobile services some information about what that user is. And you can easily check which token did that user came with. Was it from Active Directory, or was it from Facebook, or was it from some custom identity? And you can use that information to decide which group that user belongs. Typically, you also carry more claims in those tokens, and you can check the claims that are associated with the token and have even more detailed authorization logic. Like what subset of your organization is authorized to perform this particular operation.
Great. So lastly, in the fifth module, we're going to be covering push notifications. It will be a little bit of review for those of you who joined us earlier, but we are going to add a lot more detail around some more enterprise scenarios that are going to be relevant if you're building employee-facing applications. So just a quick recap of the challenges associated with push notifications. You know, this might be old hat for those of you who have been here for a couple sessions so far, but you know, for anyone who has a lot of experience developing for the web and is just getting into developing mobile applications, push can be kind of, it introduces a lot more problems as you go along. It kind of feels like a hydra. So, you know, as soon as you get done with one, you're going to find three more. So when you think about kind of the locus of challenges you're going to face, it goes all the way from cross-platform. You know, every different client platform, whether that's Windows, iOS, Android, all those platforms have different push notification services operated by the owner of that platform. So that's GCM coming from Google, that's WNS and MPNS coming from Microsoft, that's APNS coming from Apple. And they all have different protocols and payloads. So you have to build all that logic into your backend. And it's especially difficult if you're kind of going from a one-platform application to a multi-platform application. In terms of targeting based on different aspects of a user profile, so think about things like not just interest groups, but you know, what time zone are they in, what type of device do they have, so you don't send a push notification to a device that doesn't support that type. Kind of maintaining all that and being able to send targeted push notifications, in addition, not just targeted by one group, but targeted by multiple different groups, you know, being able to have Boolean expressions for any string of tags is fantastic, but very difficult to build on your own. Then also, you know, once you route the right message to the right user, that group of users might want to have it displayed differently, right, based on localization preferences, you know, anything from language to currency to Celsius versus Fahrenheit, or even just based on the device. You know, if you want to send one message, but it's going to display differently on an iPhone than it would on a Windows phone, you know, you don't want to have to send separate messages to account for that. Fourth, high volume with low latency, incredibly difficult. Incredibly difficult to achieve because you're either going to be overpaying for VMs that have to stand idle waiting for the push notification to come through, or you're going to have to find a way to spin them up very, very quickly if you want to get to a large number of users at once. And there is going to be some delay associated with that. So, you know, you're either sacrificing speed or you're incurring cost. So being able to kind of rent that capability from a dedicated service like Notification Hubs is really going to help you. And then, of course, this is one of those things where I talked about push notifications being a hydra. You know, maintaining an accurate device registry is huge. You know, if somebody uninstalls your app, but you keep trying to send them push notifications, APNS, WNS, MPNS, GCM are all going to not take very kindly to that because, you know, there's a finite amount of resources allocated to these app developers who all want to send push notifications to their users. But if somebody's, you know, revoked push privileges or uninstalled the application and you're still trying to take up the resources, you're taking away from somebody else. So making sure that you're accurate there is very, very important. And these are all things that Notification Hubs help you with. So push and mobile services, you know, we definitely recommend using Notification Hubs for push. There is push within mobile services supported. But we recommend Notification Hubs not just for the scale that we talk about on the consumer side, not just for the personalization, which is, of course, relevant in the enterprise, but for some other enterprise-type features we're going to talk about in a moment.
And you can use Notification Hubs in conjunction.
Oh, absolutely. With mobile services, yes, absolutely. So, you know, that's the recommended way of using mobile services and Notification Hubs.
And we're going to make it directly integrated so that you don't have to even think about them as two services.
Yep. Just to continue iterating on that experience, and you know, that actually came from customers that have given us that feedback. You know, people from everything like Oz Postcards to folks like TalkTalk who are saying, you know, we really need both these capabilities. You know, I still want to be able to use Notification Hubs to hook into an application backend I have. Maybe I built it a few years ago, not in mobile services, so I still need that capability. But at the same time, for my net new work, I'm really seeing a benefit in mobile services, and I'd like a more unified developer experience there. So that's definitely a priority for us. And again, just flagging that, you know, the out-of-the-box support is for kind of these four platforms, but there's nothing preventing you from using it for ADM and Kindle notifications or macOS Mavericks notifications, and, you know, everything's open source and available on GitHub. So if you want to extend what we provide, it's very easy to do so. You know, a corporate travel solution in APAC recently turned to Notification Hubs because they wanted to be able to not just send that cross-platform push notification in a single API call, but format it for different devices, and then also segment based on travel plans and status. So when we talk about tags and templates, again, that's where tags come in terms of, hey, we really want to make sure that we're not sending a weather alert notification to somebody who's going to a completely different area of the world. But then once it gets to the right person, like, let's make sure it's in the right language so they can actually read it. So definitely relevant in the enterprise. And again, Notification Hubs overview, this will be familiar for those of you who have been with us all day, but you're going to be using tags on the server side, sending that message designated You're going to designate a message to only reach a certain subset of users based on tags. If you want to reach everybody, you don't put any tags. And then it'll get routed through the different platform push notification providers, reach the correct devices, and then on the device side, on the client side, that template will be applied. So push notifications in the line of business apps definitely have a role. You know, it's everything from making the employee more effective in terms of workforce management. You know, our approvals and time cards coming in when somebody's on the go and they can take a quick look, approve or reject, instead of having to wait till they get back to their machine. You know, warehouse management. Are your employees ready to receive shipments when a truck is coming in? You know, these are features that started in consumer, but they're so relevant for the enterprise. Document approval, point of sale, and then hospitality, travel, and check-in, of course. And the list goes on and on. Push notifications really just help make your employees more effective while not kind of constraining what they can do. Then in terms of extending push notifications, there are definitely some enterprise scenarios that we didn't talk about in consumer that are important to mention. You know, everything from delivery acknowledgement, you know, you want to know that somebody received your notification, that they've opened it, that they've read, that they've absorbed the information, just like you would in certain emails with read receipt. It's an old concept, but applied to a new world, and you can accomplish that using Windows Azure. You know, when you talk about end-to-end encryption and being ready for audit, you know, using notification hubs in conjunction with services like SignalR and Service Bus are going to get you there.
Yeah, maybe I can add a few notes here. Push notifications is not just about alerts on your mobile device, right? Mm-hmm. There is also a concept of raw push notifications that is available on all the platforms. And what it allows you to do is it allows you to implement this so-called push to sync functionality, where your push notification, it just triggers the logic within your client app, to then pull additional data down. This allows you to have a very secure way of pushing data down to your app, even when the app is not running. For example, on iOS and Android, you can configure your certain functionality to run whenever a push notification arrives. And so whenever push notifications arrives, your task runs, and it can download, for example, you can sync your local cache of data using push notifications. You can do it absolutely securely. The data that you download can be encrypted. It doesn't go through APNS or GCM. Mm-hmm. It could be end-to-end encrypted between your backend and your application. Push notifications themselves are routed through APNS, GCM, etc. But at the same time, so it's a little bit hard to achieve things like acknowledged delivery, etc. But in conjunction with a pop-up service like Windows Azure Service Bus, you can achieve it by doing push and waking up the app code, and from there the app code can pull the queued up messages for that application, for that device, from a cloud PubSub system. The scenarios where you have a queue per device available to you from a cloud PubSub system like Service Bus are becoming more and more popular, and certainly are very relevant to line of business applications where you have you really need to know whether that document approval notice really got delivered to the client or not, or to the user or not. SignalR is another very important, and I'm pretty sure that you know about it already, very critical piece of framework for you to have if you want to enable asynchronous messaging from your backend to the client app. SignalR can be used in conjunction with Service Bus to scale out async notifications from the backend to the app while the app is running. And then you can use notification hubs to do native push notifications to wake up the app so that it can establish connection with SignalR and then use SignalR to push more immediate notifications directly into the app as the app is running.
Yeah, definitely a lot that you can accomplish. And again, that speaks to the extensibility that we really wanted to focus on in building these applications. You know, turnkey, and then there's extensible. So that's easy because we make it so easy to work with the different services in Azure.
I'm starting to feel good about myself.
To cover security and notification hubs, stepping back from SignalR and Service Bus for a moment, you know, authentication follows a shared access signature pattern. You know, all operations to the hubs, to the notification hub or over SSL. So we talk about not having to adjust your firewall to use notification hubs in an application backend hosted on-prem. But rest assured that all those communication channels are very secure. You know, role-based access is possible using some of the methods Kirill's covered. And there is namespace level and hub level isolation. Namespace is just able to encompass up to 50 hubs.
So it's like, there is one note I wanted to make with notification hubs is there's always a question that I get when we talk about notification hubs to the audience is, okay, I mean, my push needs are not all that sophisticated. I can build it myself. I can learn the protocols, how to talk to APNS. It's not the rocket science or GCM or WNS. I can make it do it myself. And then what happens is that you have 100 apps in your enterprise, and all of them have their own homegrown push notification systems. And now you lost control over the security and claims about who is actually allowed to send an alert and send push notification to the clients. And so you have the problems like rogue employee scenario, disgruntled employee scenario, et cetera, et cetera. Centralizing, converging your push notification systems on top of something like notification hubs, leveraging the multi-tenancy that notification apps provides to you, allows you to centralize the role-based access that you have to something like push notifications and in one place and manage it there and not have to worry about 100 different homegrown systems, which is, every developer can, in theory, recreate and do push notifications themselves at any scales they want. It's not a problem about someone's ability to do it. It's more about finding help in services like notification apps to take some of the worry off your head.
Well said. Just to close by covering best practices and resources before we go to the break. Mobile services, we covered a lot of this already in depth, so I'll let you guys kind of review the screen on download. But just to point you to the resources again, the helpful tutorials, you'll find Paolo's samples on aka.ms/commonwams. It's Chris Reisner's blog, very helpful. He's going to be publishing an application to the iOS App Store and Google Play Store soon, releasing all that code, so there's a lot of helpful samples there. Same with notification hubs, you can find a lot of Get Started content and great information on Channel 9. So thank you for joining us today. Hopefully you learned a little bit about how you can use mobile services and notification hubs in conjunction with the Windows Azure suite of services to really enable your mobile workforce and maybe even add mobility layers on top of existing systems. We're always happy to answer any questions you have. You can reach out to the team the same way you would sign up for the Active Directory preview, and that would be shooting an email to mobileservices@microsoft.com. Thank you.
Thank you.